Sylvester Stallone comes out to honor the writers.
James Stewart comes out to honor Bob Hope.
Robert Redford comes out to honor Santa Fe.
And Roy Orbison comes out to honor the 50s.
Those stories and more as the stars come out for Monday, March 21st, 1988.
What is this, Entertainment Tonight?
Everybody, I'm Lisa Gibbons. Mary Hart continues on vacation, but John, you're back.
Yes, and it's good to be here, Lisa. First, there was the writer's strike. Now, some of the most famous faces and voices in television and radio commercials are out on the picket line. And at the center of the dispute is the same hot issue, money.
No free cable! Now to the table!
This walkout, the second to hit the entertainment industry in as many weeks, pits the Screen Actors Guild and the American Federation of TV and Radio Artists against advertising companies over payment for commercials airing on cable.
The issue that's particularly at stake here is that a lot of the advertisers are doing more and more business on cable. And traditionally, of course, they've paid as residuals when they put our commercials on network television. But they refuse to give us any residuals for cable.
We feel that we ought to have access to the cable market, which represents about 50% of the viewers these days. And the networks claim in their negotiating position that their audience is shrinking. And it is shrinking, but it's going to cable.
The strike prohibits over 100,000 union members from auditioning for or appearing in commercials, but will not affect TV shows or movies.
SAG and AFTRA have notified advertisers they would work if individual interim contracts are worked out. However, advertisers are being urged to stay away from any interim agreements. In the meantime, no new commercials are being taped. The greatest impact is being felt by political candidates who until now have produced specific commercials for each primary state.
While the strike by writers continues against producers, that didn't stop the hottest stars from turning out to honor the year's best in writing achievement at the Writers Guild of America's annual awards ceremony.
In Beverly Hills, stars like Sylvester Stallone and sometime companion Cornelia Guest and others who need no introduction turned out in support of those who put the words on the page.
Writing is what makes us wonderful, pretty important actors.
Well, it'd be a hell of a lot of ad-libbing. I'd have to ad-lib my ad-libs again.
And the winner is... Steve Martin.
Steve Martin won Best Screenplay based on material from another medium for his Roxanne. He couldn't attend, but sent a speech if he won, and a speech if he didn't.
To be read if I don't win. You pigs, you idiots. You wouldn't know a good screenplay if it walked up to you and vomited on your shoe.
New York honored writers as well. John Patrick Shanley for Best Original Screenplay, Moonstruck, and a special award to Andy Rooney for refusing to write during a labor dispute with CBS Network Management.
I'm always moved to say the same thing. I'd like to thank my boss and the people who helped me with this. Unfortunately, I didn't get any help from any of them.
Despite the laughs...
Red Buttons, who used to be famous many years ago. What was the question?
There were serious concerns, like the ongoing Writers Guild strike. And what's Sly doing to support the strike?
Well, I'm not writing.
Television awards were handed out to the Golden Girls, Family Ties, and the Days and Nights of Molly Dodd for comedy. Episodes of Cagney and Lacey and Moonlighting were honored in the drama category.
And while Bob Hope was on hand to express his own appreciation to the writers for the ad-libs they provide him, Bob himself was the subject of a special tribute Saturday night, naming him Humanitarian of the Year.
Hope was named Humanitarian of the Year by the Myasthenia Gravis Foundation, an organization battling the deadly neuromuscular disease. They said thanks with a black tie benefit. Hope was honored for his humanitarian deeds and his continuing involvement in putting on shows for American soldiers around the world.
What I want to do is sing. What I love to do is sing. What I'm going to do is sing.
On this night, Ann Jillian put on her show for Hope, but the real celebrating took place at a private reception for the Hopes and some close friends.
It's hard to say enough about this man as someone who has contributed probably as much as anybody ever did.
Look in the dictionary under the word humanitarian. There's his picture, for goodness sake.
My words of tribute to Bob is that he should win every humanitarian award in the world because he deserves every one.
I'm surprised because they have so many of my leading ladies here. It's a great, great surprise.
The benefit dinner raised $250,000 for medical research.
Charlie's Angels was, of course, one of the hottest shows on television in the mid-70s and is perhaps best known for propelling Farrah Fawcett, Jacqueline Smith, Kate Jackson, and Cheryl Ladd to stardom. So it's not surprising that plans for a new series called Angels 88 is bringing would-be angels out in record numbers.
Producers say they've had almost 50,000 inquiries from girls all over the country hoping to join the new flock of angels.
I'm freezing. My feet are numb. And I just can't wait to get in and get this over with.
Once inside, mug shots were taken and each actress was interviewed. But Hollywood is looking for more than just a pretty face.
When they come and sit down in front of me, it's more than a look. We're looking for a vibrance and a personality. What of them they bring to this however brief interview.
The 11-city call has attracted all kinds of people with all kinds of reasons for showing up.
Because all my friends think I should be in Hollywood. That's why.
I'm the greatest star. I am by far, but no one knows it.
Coming up next, Robert Redford returns to the place that produced his latest labor of love.
And ahead, Yogi Berra turns film critic, plus Captain Marvel is making house calls. Don't go away. Robert Redford's latest directorial effort, The Milagro Beanfield War, opened in theaters this past weekend. To celebrate its premiere, Redford and many of the cast members journey back to the town in New Mexico, where they'd spent several months making the film.
It was fiesta time in Santa Fe last weekend as both local residents and one very famous actor-director rode in customized lowriders to the premiere of the Milagro Beanfield War. The film is a humorous drama about what happens when a farmer in drought-stricken New Mexico defies the establishment by illegally diverting water and using it to plant a bean field.
You look at Joe and he says, I'll send you a sack of beans. And I think you can smile at that.
The film was shot on location in northern New Mexico. And in a bit of role reversal, the director received more attention from the local residents than the picture's stars.
When there's a crowd of people watching his film, someone's looking at me. You know, everybody's looking at Bob, too, because they want, you know, I mean, they're attracted to him.
The Milagro Beanfield War is only Redford's second feature as a director. His first effort won him an Oscar for Ordinary People. The weekend celebrations were capped off with a reception to honor the filmmakers and to raise money for several of the local charities. Redford used the occasion to thank his stars.
The people that are on this film are ones that I have a great deal of love for. And if the public can find as much love for them as I did, then I think it'll be one big fiesta.
But the real highlight of the weekend was a special gift to Redford from the people of New Mexico.
Milagro placed 22nd at the box office this weekend, but that was only in three theaters. It opens nationally on April 1st.
Police Academy 5 was released this weekend, and like its four predecessors, it went immediately to number one at the box office. After holding that top spot for 9 weeks, Good Morning Vietnam dropped to second. And according to Entertainment Tonight box office estimates, they are followed in third by DOA, starring Dennis Quaid. Placing fourth was Vice Versa, starring Judge Reinhold. And rounding out the top five was the Rob Lowe thriller Masquerade. Now, on Friday, Alan Alda jumps back into the box office race when his latest film, A New Life, opens. All to explain to Gene Wolfe a role that takes us into the world of the newly divorced.
Husband or a pen pal?
I'm not going to let you put down our sex life. If there was something wrong with the way we made love, then I sure misinterpreted a lot of moans and groans.
Let me tell you something. What is this, Entertainment Tonight? Go buy a TV set.
We want an explanation of that reference to our show.
I was trying to find something that would bring a tear to the eye of the audience, and I thought mentioning the name of your show would do it.
Would you like to come up for a cup of coffee?
In A New Life, Alda takes a funny look at the newly divorced, awkwardly entering the world of blind dates and new relationships.
This is my floor.
Here's the thing. I don't know how this works anymore, and it makes me nervous. I'm going to have to do this step by step. I really, really would like to have coffee with you. But how would you feel about dinner first?
You don't mean tonight, right?
It's 11.
People have been trying to figure out how to make a go of it between men and women for a long time, you know, and then they called it the war between the sexes. And I don't know if we're at war with each other, but even those of us who are at peace with one another still sometimes speak a different language.
It opens in the front.
It's your creation, so we can assume that some of this is your point of view. So if you look at A New Life, will you come away with a cynical or a romantic view about the way men and women get along?
Probably not romantic, and probably not cynical. I'm definitely not romantic. I kind of cherish a healthy cynicism. I'm not talking about enjoying love. I love love. I love to be in love. But I think the highly romantic person sees love where it doesn't exist.
If so many people are living through the problems and the dilemmas you depict in this movie, what do they have to go see it in a movie for?
Well, they got to have some place to go, Nick. What? I don't know. What? I don't know. They don't have to. Let them stay home. Let them stay home and try to work things out. That's all right with me.
Alda says when people see the problems his newly single characters encounter, they'll probably stay married, at least for a while.
By the way, it was just going to be coffee.
Gene Wolfe, Entertainment Tonight.
Tomorrow on Entertainment Tonight, we'll find out if Bronson Pinchot and True Love are perfect strangers.
And on Wednesday, Matthew Broderick runs off and joins Neil Simon's army in Biloxi Blues.
Travel arrangements furnished by Delta Airlines. Every day, Delta and the Delta Connection fly to more than 230 cities worldwide. At Delta, we love to fly, and it shows.
Yogi Berra is adding another hat to his baseball cap. Yogi at the Movies marks the debut of the Houston Astros coach as a movie critic. And even in this new job, an umpire could be needed.
Yeah.
To make it as a baseball coach, this Hall of Famer is drawing on 41 years in the game. But to make it as a film critic, Yogi Berra's main credential is that he just likes movies.
I like comedy. I like a good war picture. I like the good Western. And a drama. You like A Fatal Attraction, I thought was very good, boy. There's another one. I said, boy, that goes to show you don't cheat on your wife, you know.
And this master of the malaprop doesn't have to get the actor's name right in order to give the film a good rating.
Good Morning Vietnam, you know, Roger Williams, he's a one-man gang there, you know, he's great.
Yogi at the Movies will air as 60-second spots during commercial breaks. And what does this baseball coach turned movie critic think of Three Men and a Baby?
It goes to show you three men could take care of a baby as good as one woman.
Wall Street?
I think greed's a terrible thing, not unless you're on the ground floor.
And how about Cher in Moonstruck?
She did a good job. She got the Golden Glove Award.
The only problem now may be young players more interested in his movie picks than the opposing pitcher's curveball.
Hey, Yogi, what movies are you reviewing later?
I gotta watch the game right now.
Oh.
Yogi has a 5-point rating system ranging from a strikeout to a home run. Yogi at the Movies is a syndicated series airing on about 64 stations around the country.
Now that's scary.
This whole thing is scary.
Who did he say was in Good Morning Vietnam?
Roger Williams.
Roger Williams, yes. Yeah. Go for it, Yogi. Well, Captain Marvel is back, and so are some of the other heroes from the action-packed series that highlighted many Saturday afternoons. An entire new generation of fans could be born now that the serials are available on video cassette. Leonard Maltin has the story in his film report. Leonard.
You know, I feel badly for today's kids because they don't have the experience of enjoying special Saturday matinees, which were a major part of my childhood. And a big part of the matinees was the cliffhanger serial. Now, if you've never seen a cereal, or if you want to relive the experience, Republic Home Video is releasing six of the best cereals on video this week.
Action, action, action. That was the main ingredient of the Saturday matinee cereals. They were kind of like comic books come to life. No great depth of characterization or plotting, but lots of fun with heroic good guys, nefarious bad guys, and all sorts of colorful characters, both human and superhuman. The best cereals were made by Republic Pictures, a B-movie factory that specialized in cereals and westerns for the younger set. Among the Republic cereals making their way to video are The Crimson Ghost, The Mysterious Dr. Satan, The Fighting Devil Dogs, and King of the Rocket Men. Zombies of the Stratosphere from 1952 has added trivia value because it features a young Leonard Nimoy as a Martian.
Through the water tunnel. It'll blow up soon. Destroy the whole world.
But the best of the bunch also happens to be the best cereal ever made, in my humble opinion, The Adventures of Captain Marvel from 1941. It was based on the popular comic book, made its way to the screen well before Superman ever took off in a live-action movie. Juvenile actor Frank Coughlin Jr. won the pivotal role of Billy Batson, whose encounter with a mystic figure endows him with special powers.
But who is Captain Marvel?
You are, my son. All that is necessary is to repeat my name. Shazam.
Shazam.
They had the best of people in every category, and it was people like that behind the scenes that made the Republic cereal so excellent.
Shazam!
And they could do more with less money quicker than the big shots at all the major studios.
Even after 47 years and all the high-tech special effects Hollywood has developed, Captain Marvel still has the power to amaze and entertain an audience with its simplicity, sincerity, and gee whiz brand of old-fashioned entertainment. Plus, of course, those incredible cliffhanger endings to every chapter.
Now, in the old days, you'd have to wait a whole week to find out how they got out of that predicament. Now you can just press the fast forward on your video machine and watch the next chapter. That's one advantage the kids years ago never had, and I'm sure never dreamt of.
Thanks, Leonard. So is it Shazam or Shazam?
Shazam.
Shazam.
I thought so.
Stay with us when we come back. Dean Martin has had to leave the nationwide tour with Frank and Sammy. We'll tell you more about that. And we'll bebop at the sock hop with Disney's hottest stars of the 50s.
Celebrating a birthday today, actor Matthew Broderick is 26. Actor Eugene Williams, 29. Comedian Brad Hall is 30. Singer Eddie Money, 39. Actor Al Freeman Jr., 54. And band leader Mort Lindsey is 65.
In our People postscripts today, singer Dean Martin has entered a Los Angeles hospital for treatment of a kidney problem. Martin, along with Frank Sinatra and Sammy Davis Jr., have been touring nationally on their much-publicized Together Again tour. Dean Martin played the Chicago Theater over the weekend, appearing on stage with his two longtime pals, Frank and Sammy.
Don't know what's coming tomorrow. Maybe it's funny and sorrow, but we'll travel the road, carrying our load side by side.
Backstage, Martin seemed his usual easygoing self, clowning around as he signed the theater's celebrity wall.
I am.
A spokesman for the group told Entertainment Tonight that Sinatra and Davis will continue the tour. It picks up tomorrow night in Bloomington, Minnesota.
Stars from the 50s turned up at Disneyland this weekend for an old-fashioned sock hop. The festivities mark the opening of a new spring attraction, Blast to the Past, celebrating the fads, fun, and music of the period.
The headliner at the sock hop was Roy Orbison, and hoofing it on the dance floor were the likes of the Lone Ranger, Jimmy Olsen, and Lois Lane, and even Buddy Epson. The 50s was a time that many of these entertainers were at their peak. But that's not the only reason the decade is so fondly remembered.
It was a happy, cheerful time when the war was over and everybody was enjoying life. And it was, I think, a very loving, you know, special kind of a time. And I think that's why it's coming back.
I mean, those were the days of cheap perfume, Angora sweaters, lower your car. We were just dreamers.
But for others, the 50s wasn't the only time to have a good time.
I like the 20s myself.
I'm totally into the 80s. But this is fun. I'm enjoying this.
Did you have a crush on Cookie when you were a kid?
Everybody had a crush on Cookie.
Yeah. You're not old enough to have. Nice. You even remember him.
Nice compliment, John, but not true, unfortunately.
Nice try anyway, right?
Yeah. That's going to do it for us today. But tomorrow we'll have an inside look at The Last Emperor from the kids who played the title role as the emperor was growing up.
And we'll leave you with more of the blast to the past at Disneyland. The song is the 1962 hit Dream Baby. It's sung by Roy Orbison. Take care.
See you tomorrow. Make my time my dreaming. You can make my dreams come true. Yeah, sweet.